Good morning. Good morning. Good to see everybody this morning on this beautiful Sunday morning. Bright sunshine after a gloomy Saturday. But we praise the Lord for the rain because we needed it. And we praise the Lord that we did not have the bad weather they had above us up north. So we'll continue to remember those folks this morning. But this morning we're going to sing praises to God this morning and uplift His name. So if you'll take your red hymnal, turn to hymn number 181 and then also 180. We will sing Joy to the World. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4, and then we will flip back to the first Noel and sing the first verse of that. So if you would, please stand as we sing.
The Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no lodging available for them. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger."
Continue singing this morning. Take your hymnals, turn to hymn number 202. 202, How Great Our Joy. We'll do all four verses, and I'll let you remain seated for those.
Christmas story. We're going to talk a little bit about what Courtney just read a few moments ago. Talk about those shepherds. Hey, sir. Let's see what you're doing. Yeah, see about all these boys. Looks like my house most of the time when grandkids are there. Lots of boys. It's a good thing. So, Miss Courtney, or Mommy, however you want to refer to her, read about the story a while ago that in the scripture. But can you imagine being out in this field and it's dark? It's real dark. And you have to remember, there were no car lights then because there were no cars. There were no street lights, no flashlights, no... They might have had a little fire going, maybe some little torches going with light, but it was dark. And all of a sudden, an angel appears. That would be wild, wouldn't it? An angel appeared and come talk to you. And then the sky lit up because of God's glory. The sky lit up so bright as if it was daylight. Yeah. Tell Maverick's my amen corner here. And I'm not surprised that the shepherds were scared to death. They were so afraid. I would be too, wouldn't you? Yeah. But the angel told them, don't be afraid, because they had some very good news. Yeah, good news that was going to bring a great joy to everybody. And that's that Jesus, a Savior, had been born. And he told them how to find him. Okay. Yeah. I better be careful saying okay. Yeah. So then they went, the shepherds left, and they went and went to Bethlehem, and they found Mary and Joseph, just like the angel had told them. And then they went, and everybody they told was amazed at what they told them. Those shepherds were hardworking people to begin with, taking care of sheep, and then they had a very important task, and that was to go see baby Jesus, and then tell others about it. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for those shepherds, and thank you, Father, for Christmas when we celebrate the birth of Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
How could it be, this baby in my arms, sleeping now so peacefully, the Son of God, the angel said, how could it be? Not my own, not of my flesh, not of my bone. Still, Father, let this baby be a son of my love. Father, show of yours. How can a man be father to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? He looks so small, his face and hands so fair. And when he cries, the sun just seems to disappear. But when he laughs, it shines again. How could it be? Father, show so peacefully, the Son of God, the angel said, how could it be?
I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. You ever wondered how many times in our lifetime we've heard the Christmas story read from Scripture? It's been a lot, hasn't it? Several times every year. And after a while, we wonder, is there anything new there? But the reality is, there doesn't need to be anything new there. It's a great event in human history, in eternal history, that transforms all of the world. The birth of this baby Jesus. And the events surrounding the birth of Jesus, they're another reminder of the sovereignty of God. Nothing that happened was a surprise to God. Nothing caused God to change his divine plan. Before the creation of the world, before he spoke the words and the first thing was created, every detail of the birth of his son had been planned. So as we turn to Luke chapter 2, and we begin to look at the details surrounding the birth of Jesus, remember that this was all in the divine plan of God the Father. So as we look even at that very first verse, Caesar Augustus calls for a census, a registration of the entire world. Caesar Augustus may have thought that it was his plan to call for the census. He may have thought it was the Roman Empire's plan to call that all the world should be registered, that there should be a census. The reality was that this plan started in the mind of God before time ever began on earth. But here's the question. Why would God care about a census being taken? Why would he care about everybody going back to their hometown to be registered in their city of their family heritage? Well, that's part of the reason. As a result of the census, everyone went to his own town, the home of their family origin, to register. And since both Joseph and Mary were descendants of David, they took that difficult 70-mile journey to a town called Bethlehem, that in verse 4 of Luke 2 identifies as the city of David. Well, why was it necessary for them to go to Bethlehem? Well, it was necessary for Joseph and Mary to go to Bethlehem to fulfill prophecy concerning the birthplace of Jesus. Micah chapter 5, verse 2 says, "But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler of Jerusalem, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient of days." Hundreds of years before Jesus was born, the Spirit of God put into the heart and the mind of the prophet Micah to say, in Bethlehem, the Messiah, Jesus, the Christ, would be born. So sure enough, while Joseph and Mary were in Bethlehem, verse 6 says, the time came for her to give birth.
Now we can look at this on a purely physical level and say, well, of course it was time for her to give birth. She was 9 months pregnant. Oh, but God had something else in mind. It wasn't just time for her to give birth because she was 9 months pregnant that she carried him to term. God planned when she would become pregnant, and he planned when she would give birth. It was God's time for Jesus to be born. That statement, the time came for her to give birth, tells us that in God's divine plan, it was time for Jesus to be born. God is sovereign, and he is in control of all things. Every detail of his birth was planned and carried out according to the perfect will of God. In verse 7, Luke then tells us that she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. And then God sends an angel to the shepherds who were going about their normal nightly task of caring for their sheep. And the angel announced to the shepherds good news of great joy that the Savior had been born. And then look at verses 10 through 12 because that's where we're going to settle in for this message this morning. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." Notice in the middle of verse 10, what the angel said, "I bring you good news of great joy." Good news of great joy. So let's answer this question this morning. Why did the angel describe the news about the Savior's birth as good news of great joy? First of all, the news about the Savior's birth brings great joy because it is good news for sinners. It's for sinners. Back in verse 9, we see when the angel appeared to the shepherds, they were filled with great fear. Well, of course they were filled with great fear. Who wouldn't be? As I was just sharing with the children, it was dark, it was night, they may have had a little flicker of a fire going as they cared for those very important sheep. And all of a sudden, the sky is brighter than the brightest day when the glory of the Lord shone around them. Wow. Who wouldn't be afraid? And then the angel said to the shepherds, "For unto you is born this day a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Savior. Why a Savior? Why was a Savior born? Because our greatest problem is that we're sinners. And the fact that a Savior was born is truly good news for sinners. But the only people who recognize that they need a Savior are those who recognize that they are sinners. But the truth is, in spite of what many people think, many people don't think they're sinners. Oh, they might make a little mistake, or they might tell a little white lie, or they may say something they shouldn't say, they may misspeak. Our society has developed all kinds of terms to say everything but what we are, and that is sinners. Because we want to feel good about ourselves. But the truth is that we are all sinners desperately in need of a Savior. And the truth is also that without a Savior, the penalty for sin is eternity in hell. So Jesus Christ left the glory of heaven, came to earth, was born of a virgin, was fully God, was fully man, died on the cross for our sins, and conquered death by rising from the dead. This is the Savior who was born, and the angel announced his birth to the shepherds. We're sinners. And it is only when we recognize that we are sinners that the news of the Savior brings great joy. We're thankful there's a Savior. Second of all, the news about the Savior brings great joy because it is true. So much of what we see on television today, or hear on the radio, or read in the paper, or read online, we automatically must ask the question, is it true? Because much of it, we find out, is not true at some point. But this good news of great, that brings great joy, is true. So many people today, other religions and other people, they will not acknowledge that Jesus is God. They will not acknowledge that he's the Savior. Oh, he's a great teacher. He was a great teacher. He was a prophet. He was a kind man. He healed people. He was a wonderful man. But in reality, either Jesus was born to be the Savior or he was not. Jesus did not come to earth just to be a healer or a great teacher. Jesus came to be the Savior. And Luke wants it to be clear in his gospel that everyone knows this is true. Flip back in your Bibles if you have them open to chapter 1. And I want us to look, I'm just going to read it. I want you to look. The first three verses of chapter 1, Luke really gives the credentials here of why it's true about everything he's writing. He says, "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses," so he states there's eyewitnesses, "and ministers of the word have delivered them to us. It seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly conduct." So what he's saying is, this is from eyewitnesses, eyewitness accounts. This is what we saw. This is what we heard. What you're about to read, he says to his first readers and to us, what you're about to read is true. And I was reading this week that most scholars believe that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was Luke's primary source for the account of Jesus' birth. Well, who better to be the primary source, right? She was there. She had to be there. Look at chapter 2 of Luke, verse 19. "Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart." Don't you know that for the rest of her life on this earth, Mary thought about often the events of that journey to Bethlehem, the events of Jesus' birth, the events of his life, the events of his death, the events of his resurrection? I mean, if you and I, if we experience something in our life and it's a tremendous experience, whether it's a joyous, wonderful experience or if it's a tragedy of some kind, don't we think about it from time to time? Don't we reflect on it? Well, surely Mary reflected on this for the rest of her life. And she shared it with Luke, and it was true. The witness of the shepherds further confirms the historical truth of these events. Verse 20 of Luke chapter 2, "And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen." All that they had heard and seen, they were eyewitnesses. And they said what they had heard and seen, it was just as it had been told to them. Those things they had heard and seen, a common couple with a baby in a barn, those are not the kinds of things people would make up. Now, when people were going to make up a story about the birth of a Savior, it would have sounded more like a fairy tale, would it have not? With the birth taking place in a palace in Jerusalem, not a manger in Bethlehem. Everything would have been majestic, not common, not ordinary. Now, certainly there are miracles all through the birth account of Jesus. The virgin birth is an incredible miracle. The appearance of angels, what a life-changing miracle for the shepherds. But notice how these are presented in the Gospels. These events are presented in Scripture as the straightforward report of eyewitnesses, not of some spectacular event that was made up. The truth of the Savior's birth is also confirmed by many fulfillments of Old Testament prophecy. The prophet Isaiah in chapter 6, verses 6 and 7, prophesied that the Messiah would be a descendant of David. And then you turn to Matthew's Gospel in chapter 1 and Luke's Gospel in chapter 3, and they list the genealogy of Jesus, which verifies that this prophecy was fulfilled. This is great news because it's true. The prophet Isaiah in chapter 7, verse 14, prophesied that the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. But then listen to what the angel said to Joseph in chapter 1 of Matthew. An angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She shall bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. And then the fact that Jesus was born in Bethlehem was prophesied by the prophet, and it was fulfilled. All prophecies were fulfilled. Eyewitnesses told the truth of what they had seen. So Jesus' conception, his birth, his ministry, his death, his resurrection was a fulfillment of prophecy and was verified by hundreds of reliable witnesses. Jesus is the Savior, and that brings good news of great joy because this news is true. It's true. Leads us to the third point, and that is the news about the Savior brings great joy because it is news of Christ the Lord. Look at verse 11 of Luke chapter 2. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Let's think about the uniqueness of the Savior born in Bethlehem. So unique. Jesus is the Christ, Luke says here. The Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. He was sent by the Father, and he was sent by the Father to come to earth for a mission of salvation. Why was he sent? Because he alone is able to reconcile sinful people to God through his sacrificial death and resurrection. No one else could accomplish that, only Jesus. He is the Christ. Goes on and says, He is Christ the Lord. The Savior born in Bethlehem is God in human flesh. He is fully God. He is fully man. Now, don't ask me to explain that any deeper than I just did, because I can't and neither can you. Our minds can't comprehend it. Our words can't describe it, can't define it. But it is true, he was fully God and fully man. If he had been born only a man, he could not have saved us by dying on the cross. The lambs that were sacrificed, the lambs that were sacrificed for sins on the altar, they had to be deemed perfect, without spot or blemish. And only Jesus Christ, as the perfect Lamb of God, could sacrificially die for our sins. He was unique. He is Christ the Lord. Leads me to a question. We talk about this a good bit, particularly in our Bible studies. Every detail of Scripture means something. There's no fluff here. As I've said time and time again, when I was in school and had to have a 10-page paper, 8 pages of it might be content, and at least 2 or 3 or 4, sometimes 5, were fluff to get to 10 pages. No fluff in Scripture. Everything means something. Which leads me to a question. Have you ever wondered why the Bible specifies that Mary, in verse 7 and verse 12, is specified that Mary wrapped the newborn Jesus in swaddling cloths? Why is that important? I will say it's not important just so we can be sure about Mary's mothering skills, that she kept the baby warm. It's not there for that reason. So why is this detail important? In his book called Jesus, a Theography, a man by the name of Leonard Sweet, he describes those Bethlehem shepherds' care of the lambs that will be offered as sacrifices. Bethlehem shepherds had an important role. They had to care for and prepare those lambs, those sheep, for sacrifice. And they had to be perfect. They had to be perfect. They had to learn and follow special techniques to care for those very special lambs. Listen to what Leonard Sweet says of what they did. Quote, he says, "To prevent harm and self-injury from thrashing about after birth on their spindly legs, newborn lambs were wrapped in swaddling cloths. Then they were placed in a manger or feeding trough where they could calm down out of harm's way." So what does this mean? Leonard Sweet continues and says, "The shepherds who gathered around the Bethlehem stable where the Lamb of God was born were not witnessing anything new except for who was in the manger, the perfect Lamb of God." The shepherds would wrap the lambs in swaddling cloths and lay them in the manger, and now we have here the perfect Lamb of God, wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. That answers part of the question, is why were the first witnesses to the birth of Jesus shepherds? They may have understood the scene there that night better than the religious leaders, because they knew about wrapping lambs in swaddling cloths and lying them in a manger. But now they were looking at the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Every detail of Jesus' birth, even being wrapped in swaddling cloths, was planned by God, because it points to the reason Jesus came, and that was to be the perfect Lamb of God who died on the cross for our sins. That leads us to the final point. The news about the Savior brings great joy because it is for all people. All people. I want you to notice in these verses the personal nature of the angel's announcement to the shepherds. Look back at verses 10 through 12. The angel said to the shepherds, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy." They didn't say, "I bring it to the whole world." Well, yes, eventually it would be for the whole world, but right now it's for you, the shepherds. "I bring you good news of great joy." And then the angel says, that will be for all the people. Goes on in verse 11, for unto you the shepherds, is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you the shepherds, you will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. This news of the Savior's birth was a personal message for the shepherds and for all people. Even this first announcement of Jesus' birth proclaims that the gospel is for everyone. I mean, think about it. Even the location of his birth, a manger in a stable, a barn, reminds us that the gospel is for all people. I mean, think about it. Who is excluded from a barn? No one. Everyone's welcome in a barn. Even the fact that the news of Jesus' birth is first announced to lowly shepherds remind us that the gospel is for all the people. Again, if the shepherds can come, and they were the first ones invited, if they can come, everyone is welcome to come to Christ. No one's excluded. Jesus came to offer salvation to all the people. That's what the angel told the shepherds. Do you remember what Jesus said to his disciples just before he ascended? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, of all the people. Then he said again in Acts 1:8, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth, to all the people. The angel's message to the shepherds is giving us a preview, giving the world a preview of why he came and who he came for. Jesus came for all the people. The gospel, the grace of God, is available to anyone who will receive him as Savior and Lord. Now that's good news of great joy. As we close, the angel proclaimed to those shepherds good news of great joy. You know what our problem is, though, when it comes to joy? We look for happiness and think we're looking for joy. That's the problem. And we look for it in all kinds of places and all kinds of things that can't bring joy. They might bring happiness for a little while, but they don't bring the eternal joy that Jesus came to give. So the truth is that joy is only found in Jesus. Happiness can be found in multitudes of places and ways, but joy, the joy that the angel spoke of, the joy of Christ, the joy of the Lord, is only found in Jesus. It's only found when we repent of our sins and surrender to Jesus Christ as Lord. It's only found when we surrender our lives to Jesus Christ and follow him as Lord. That's the only place we find is in Jesus. And it's only found in him when we surrender to him, surrender our life to him. It's only found in him when we, after we've surrendered our life to him, that we obediently follow him. That's the only joy. It's in Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, we just give you praise and glory that joy is available, because so often we and the world, we look for happiness, thinking we're looking for joy. But Father, we thank you, we praise you that joy is available and is free if we surrender and we obey Jesus Christ. Father, search our hearts. Search our hearts. And if there's anything in our heart that is displeasing to you, reveal that to us, point it out to us, and lead us to confess of our sins and repent and turn to you. Father, forgive us if we are looking for happiness, thinking we're looking for joy. May we always look to you for the only joy that's available. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our hymn of decision is Good Christian Men Rejoice, hymn 183. If you need to respond publicly this morning, won't you come as we stand and sing? Moon and our IMB missionaries, and
we all lead busy lives, but if we could just stop everything and take a bird's eye view a little higher, there now we can see the multitudes. We are fueled by a shared vision to bring the name of Christ to those who are yet to hear. So we move forward to extreme places, corners of the world that have no access to the gospel. The trained missionaries send them out together and pray that God's grace be known. We help the hurting, comfort the dying, give hope to the displaced, and have seen thousands come to faith in Christ. We are able to do so much more together than if we were chasing this vision alone. This is our common effort. Together.
This reminds us that our part as we pray and as we give make a difference. They make our prayers and our gifts to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering make a tremendous difference, as makes it available for people like Ronnie and Gail to do their ministry and share the gospel with others. So keep that in mind, and
and if there are still envelopes available and you have not given or you want to give again, check the entrances and see if there's envelopes. If not, you can just take any of our envelopes and write Lottie Moon on it, and our counters will know where that goes. And I'm still recording.